He was a feared gangster, a ruthless enforcer, and moneymaker for the mob. Known as the Grim Reaper, he was well respected throughout the New York City underworld and beyond. He would strike fear into the hearts of his enemies and was always one step ahead of law enforcement. But he had a very dark secret. A secret, if revealed, would lead to his execution by the mob. This is the story of the Grim Reaper, Greg Scarpa. Gregory Scarpa was born on the 8th of May 1928 in Brooklyn, New York. He grew up on the South Side in Bensonhurst. His father, Salvatore, made his money hauling coal, which was a backbreaking and miserable job. His daughter, Linda Scarpa, would later recall how young Greg disliked going into his father's dirty and rugged work. He was far too ambitious to settle into such a fate. Instead of hauling coal with his dad, Greg had his eye on a different kind of lifestyle altogether. There were older men in the neighborhood that drove nice cars and wore fancy clothes. They always seemed to have lots of money, yet few of them even held actual jobs. They were living the life that Greg and his older brother Sal wanted. The Scarpa brothers became associates of the Profaci crime family, basically young, thuggish debt collectors. Greg in particular had a nasty streak that frightened people. Scarpa proved his loyalty and capabilities over the next several years, and it paid off. Greg fit the bill physically too. He was 6 foot tall and a very muscular 200 pounds. He was also a fearless enforcer and a big earner. In 1953, the mafia bosses decided to test Scarpa to see if he was ready for the big time. They ordered Scarpa to kill a man, and he coldly did it without hesitation. He would soon be officially made into the Profaci family, which later became the Colombo family. He became a protege of Carmine the Snake Persico, who was a rising star in the family at the time. Scarpa was involved in traditional strong-arm rackets, such as illegal gambling, loan sharking, extortion, hijacking, narcotics, and murder. Working under his mentor, Charlie the Sig Lo Cicero, Scarpa impressed his fellow mob friends and quickly rose through the ranks to become a captain of his own crew. In the early 1960s, however, Scarpa's luck finally ran out when he was arrested for armed robbery. In order to avoid a jail sentence, Scarpa agreed to be an informant for the FBI. This would mark the start of a 30-year relationship between the FBI and Scarpa. In 1963, a made man in the Genovese family called Joe Valachi testified at a Senate hearing about organized crime. Valachi told the world that the mafia did exist and its influence in the unions. It is thought that a majority of the information used in the hearing actually came from reports from Greg Scarpa. Valachi was the face of the information. In the 1960s, the US was in the grips of civil rights unrest. In the summer of 1964, three civil rights workers in the South had disappeared, presumed murdered. FBI were under pressure to act, but had difficulties finding witnesses. Unable to legally use strong-arm interrogation techniques, they sent in Scarpa with a mission to find out where the bodies were buried. Scarpa was given money, a gun, and sent to Mississippi. Scarpa, along with another FBI agent, kidnapped a Klansman member who the FBI suspected of being involved. Some accounts say that Scarpa put a barrel in the man's mouth to get him to tell them where the bodies were. After several lies, Scarpa tortured him, threatening to cut off his private parts. In fear for his life, he gave Scarpa the information and the bodies were soon located. He was rewarded with money. In 1966, a family man named Vernon Dahmer allowed his local store to be used for voter registration. Klansmen found out where he lived and turned up with shotguns and gasoline and proceeded to burn his house down. Dahmer managed to hold the attackers at bay whilst his family escaped, but later died in his wife's arms. Once again, local police and FBI had difficulties in finding the people responsible. They sent in Scarpa. Scarpa used similar techniques to extract information, which eventually led to agents finding the perpetrators. The man was beaten so badly, he confessed in his involvement with the murder. The FBI's relationship with Scarpa would come to a grinding halt when both parties had a disagreement on the payment for the job, and Scarpa was dropped as a confidential informant. In 1980, FBI agent Lindley DeVecchio became Scarpa's contact and handler and restarted his relationship with the Bureau. Scarpa had refused contact with the FBI for the previous 5 years, but DeVecchio persuaded him to cooperate again. Linda Shiro, Scarpa's long-term girlfriend, and federal prosecutors later claimed that Scarpa had numerous illegal dealings with DeVecchio. Scarpa allegedly provided DeVecchio with cash, jewelry, and other gifts, along with information of questionable value on the Columbos. In return, DeVecchio allegedly protected Scarpa from arrest and provided him with information about his rivals during the Third Columbo War. Information he provided helped the FBI with the 1985 commission case that led to the convictions of 4 out of the 5 bosses of the New York mob. Although he was working as a CI for the FBI, Scarpa's crimes continued. He was still committing murders. Scarpa's trademark when killing his enemies was to take a handkerchief out of his pocket. When he'd put the handkerchief back into his pocket, he'd pull out a gun and kill his target. There was one incident where Scarpa had heard that a fellow mobster accused him of being a rat behind his back. Scarpa called him in, asked him if he had proof. The man replied no, and he was killed on the spot. In the code of the mob, calling someone a rat without proof was a death sentence. Scarpa took full advantage of the rule. Scarpa was taking 3 aspirins daily since his early 20s. This caused numerous ulcers in his stomach. After having emergency ulcer surgery at the Victoria Memorial Hospital in Brooklyn in 1986, Scarpa received several blood donations from family members and associates. Scarpa had refused blood from the hospital blood bank. Scarpa eventually got blood from the mobster Paul Mellet, a bodybuilder who was using injectable anabolic steroids. Mellet had contracted HIV from a dirty needle and unknowingly transmitted it to Scarpa in the blood transfusion. Surgeons at Mount Sinai Hospital in Manhattan eventually removed Scarpa's stomach. On August 30th, 1992, he received a $300,000 settlement in civil court from his first surgeon and Victory Hospital for negligence. As Scarpa's illness progressed to AIDS, he and his relatives told everyone that he was suffering from cancer. In 1991, supporters of Columbo rebel and acting boss Victor Orena attempted to kill Scarpa. Earlier in 1991, a struggle between Orena and imprisoned Columbo boss Carmine Persico resulted in violence. Persico's loyalists had unsuccessfully attempted to kill Orena at his Brooklyn home. In retaliation, Orena decided to murder Scarpa, one of Persico's strongest supporters. On November 18th, 1991, Scarpa was driving his own vehicle in Brooklyn, followed behind by his daughter and grandson, when he was stopped by two cars. Hitmen ran out from their vehicles with guns drawn and converged on Scarpa's car. But Scarpa managed to drive away from the ambush, crashing into anything that got in his way. A few bystanders were injured, but Scarpa and his relatives escaped unharmed. During the seven-month conflict between Persico and Orena, Scarpa served as Persico's military commander. Although weakened by illness, he constantly cruised along Avenue U in Brooklyn, looking for Orena supporters in social clubs and bars. Incensed by the murder attempt on his family, Scarpa was especially watchful for Orena loyalist William Cutelo, who had organized it. Over the next few weeks, Scarpa and his associates killed Orena loyalists Rosario Nastassa, Vincent Fusaro, and James Malpiso. Scarpa allegedly shot Fusaro as he was hanging Christmas lights on his house. In 1992, Scarpa's AIDS lawsuit was settled with $300,000 in cash payments to his family. Whilst appearing at a New York civil courtroom for his medical lawsuit, Scarpa was arrested for violating state firearms laws. Soon after, he was indicted on federal racketeering charges involving three murders. On December 29, 1992, while under house arrest with an electronic monitoring device, Scarpa lost an eye in a shootout with other mobsters. Two Lucchese family mobsters, Michael DeRosa and Ronald Moran, had threatened Joey Scarpa, Gregory's son, over a drug deal. Climbing out of bed, the elder Scarpa drove with Joey to DeRosa's house and shot DeRosa. Moran fired back and hit Scarpa in the eye. Back at his house, Scarpa allegedly poured some Scotch whiskey into his wound, assured the authorities everything was fine, and later went to the hospital. Prosecutors revoked Scarpa's house arrest and sent him to jail. By 1993, Scarpa was blind in one eye, emaciated, and in poor health. He pleaded guilty to three murders and conspiracy to murder several others. On December 15th, 1993, Scarpa was sentenced to life in federal prison. This sentence was later reduced to 10 years due to Scarpa's poor health. On June 4th, 1994, Gregory Scarpa Sr. died in the Federal Medical Center for Prisoners in Rochester, Minnesota, from AIDS-related complications. It was the end of one of the most feared gangsters in the mob, the Grim Reaper, Greg Scarpa.